Good afternoon. It's good to see you gathered here. I just watching people greet and share and, you know, why it takes perhaps moments like this for us to see people we haven't seen forever. You think we would finally get it in our brain how important we are to each other, family and friends. But please, please take advantage of this time. I know after this celebration of life, this memorial, there'll be food and fellowship in the room right across the hall from the sanctuary, and you're invited there, okay? But welcome. We're here to really celebrate life, to give thanks to God for Harvey Clampett. And I don't know about you guys, but looking at this picture, that is awesome. You know, it makes me really want to get to know this man. I never had the chance to meet him, but oh, that fedora, that little goat he has on his, oh, yeah, he looked like a character, but a man of character as well. How blessed you were to have had him in your life. And Betty, my love and my heart to you. I know you are struggling with your own health, but you are here to give thanks to God for this amazing man who you were blessed with. My love goes out to all of you. We're here to, we are so unique in this world as far as life forms. We were created in the image of God. And when one of us has a curtain closed in her life, we gather together and somehow we find another curtain raising to remind us that life continues, and it does. And seeing the kids around here, I'm going to say to the kidlins, you be who you are, okay? You do your thing, because the sound of your voices is just heaven sent. And you are our hope. You are the dreams we have, we instill upon you. And so we're here to celebrate life, to give thanks to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who says, though we may die, yet shall we live, for whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. That soul, that spirit within us, that is eternal. It's the essence of God's image, of love, and we are here to remind ourselves of that as we gather together as family and friends. And wherever you are in your faith, or wherever you are in your questions and your doubts, no, you know, this is a place to just gather together in the presence of loved ones and to ponder where that love came from. And I am here to just walk with you, and whatever you're feeling, it's good. It's where you're at. So don't feel like you need to be full of emotion one way or the other. This is a celebration of life. And with that said, let us turn in prayer to God. Almighty God, we come together to just say thanks for the precious gift of life. Oh my gosh. It can blindside us some ways, and what happens, this roller coaster, this existence we have upon this good green earth you have gifted us with. And there are times like this when we gather to express our thanks to you for this amazing man. This man who obviously has touched the hearts of many and will continue to do so. Be with us. Be with us wherever we are in our faith journey. May we just saddle up next to each other, lean upon one another at a time like this, and share the memories and the hopes and the dreams, and to continue to forge ahead. Because knowing the man that I've heard about with respect to Harvey, dear God, he would want every person here to continue to live life to its fullest and to be there for each other and to help each other in any possible manner that we are capable of doing. To build family, to build friendships, to set aside those moments to realize the most precious thing we have when we sit down next to each other, across the table, or hold hands side by side. It's these relationships. It's these relationships. May we nurture them, dear God. And may we continue to hold on to the memory of Harvey within our hearts and our lives. For he has impacted those within this room and outside these walls of this sanctuary. Thank you for your son, who empowers us to be here with the assurance that death has no hold ultimately over us. The grave has no victory because of your son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. I want to share the obituary here that was put out. And my 62-year-old eyes need a little help. Harvey J. Clampett, 93, of Nampa, Idaho, passed away on January 6, 2024. He is survived by his wife, Betty Jean Novus, his daughter, Julie Jenkins, and his son, Alan Clampett. Harvey was preceded in death by his son, Bob Clampett. Harvey had a distinguished military career, having joined the Navy at the age of 17. He proudly served his country for 9 years before retiring from the Navy. Harvey's dedication and commitment to the military were exemplary. After his military service, Harvey embarked on a successful career. He worked for the Rucker Company for 7 years and later joined the Naval Base Alameda, where he worked until his retirement after 21 years. Harvey's dedication and hard work were evident throughout his professional life. In his free time, Harvey had a passion for various hobbies. He took great pride in maintaining immaculate yards and a pool, showcasing his love for landscaping. Harvey also enjoyed entertaining family and friends at his home. He had a great talent for working on and refurbishing cars, which I'm envious of anyone who could do that, always having a car project keeping him busy. Additionally, he loved traveling in his mobile home, exploring new places, and creating cherished memories along the way. Harvey J. Clampett will always be remembered for his dedication to his family, country, his strong work ethics, and his passion for his hobbies. He leaves a legacy of love and cherished memories. May his soul rest in peace. Absolutely. As I was listening to a couple family members last week, getting a sense of the man that Harvey was, and spending time with that, and you know, the obituary, and I came across some scripture that I just thought this emanated Harvey and his life. Okay, so I'm going to share just a few scriptures. They're all brief, except one about 5 verses long. First one is from Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. And this kind of gives us a sense of what God created us to do in a very basic and simple way. And it just reminded me of Harvey. Then the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to cultivate it and keep it. Right? First job we were given by God, take care of this world, take care of the garden. And then from Exodus chapter 35, and there's a gentleman who's lifted up in these scriptures, and it's verses 30 through 36, and a gentleman's lifted up, his name, Bazael, and I thought, Bazael, I see a little of Harvey in him. Then Moses said to the sons of Israel, see, the Lord has called by name Bazael, the son of Uri, the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah. And he has filled him with the Spirit of God in wisdom and understanding and in knowledge and in all craftsmanship to make designs for working in gold and in silver and in bronze and in the cutting of stones for setting and in the carving of wood so as to perform in every inventive work, to be creative. He also put in Bazael's heart to teach. He has filled him with skill to perform every work of an engraver and of a designer and of an embroiderer in blue and in purple and in scarlet material and in fine linen and of a weaver as performers of every work and makers of design. Now, Bazael and every skillful person in whom the Lord has put skill and understanding to know how to perform all the work in the construction of the sanctuary shall perform in accordance with all that the Lord has commanded. And I'm just looking at this very creative man who had this skill to create and bring beauty into this world and to manipulate wood and various designs. I'm just thinking, I'm kind of seeing Harvey there a bit. Doing it as the Lord has commanded, to do what you were created to do. Colossians 3:23. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart, as if you're working for the Lord. Great words. And these from this verse from Acts 20, verse 35. In everything I did, this is Paul was saying, I showed you that by this kind of hard work, we must help the weak, remembering the words of the Lord Jesus himself, who said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. And finally, scripture that is often used at a time like this, timeless words that remind us that we do not walk this journey alone, that our Lord is with us no matter what valley we may find ourselves in. From Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. He maketh me lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest the table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. May God's blessings be upon these words to encourage us, to give us hope, promise, and peace. Amen. Okay, we're going to see a little video tribute to Harvey. And Katie, if you would start that would be awesome. Wasn't it? That was beautiful. Yeah, whoever put that together. Great music. From Catch a Falling Star to Heaven. Must be missing an angel. Who's Tavares? Is that who sings that? Yeah. Shows you my, where I grew up with. Dean Martin. Oh my gosh. You can't beat Odino and then a song. Simon and Garfunkel penned. Oh, great music. Great music. With that said, you are that continuing melody of Harvey's life. And it was kind of intentional to show the video tribute of his life to see if it might stir or place within your heart a memory or a thought that you would like to share here this afternoon. I have a mic here. It's a handheld, so I can bring it to you so you don't have to come up front. Just make it easier. And you know, public speaking isn't the easiest thing to do, and especially when you have a lot of emotion. So, you know, at times like this, sometimes we get too many people, sometimes we get no one. And I get it. I so get it. And I guess I need to turn this on, don't I? Haha. So, certainly, is there someone who would like to share a thought, a memory, a word, a story? And I'll bring this to you. Okay.
Thank you. Uh-huh. Well, that was a beautiful, beautiful tribute to Dad. You know, Dad was a loving son, husband, father, friend, and many other things. And I wanted to just say, you know, my husband and I, we used to go disco dancing with Mom and Dad. I guess that's probably been a few years ago now, but we sure had a great time. And when we were kids, we liked to go to Disneyland and do fun things like that. And Dad took us those things. And, you know, life, like you were saying, has its things that you're not planning on. You know, he lost two children, a baby that was when I was 5 years old that they lost, and my brother Bob, who now he can be with them. Just a minute. And I've had a few people tell me that he set an example to them about how to be a good father and a husband. Thank you.
Thank you. I know it's not easy, but it meant so much to him for you to share those words. Come on. Okay. Anyone else?
Yeah.
All right. There you go, my friend.
So my father, you know, he was teaching me things that I didn't even realize I was learning growing up. You know, and you know, he we butt heads a lot. Oh man, did we ever? But that's just the way it is between a father and son, I guess. Growing up. And I just don't know what else to throw in there, but he was a really good dad. Yeah. And that's all I have to say, really. Thanks.
Right? It really does. We don't have to fill the air with words, you know. What's in here, my friend?
Oh. I had a lot of really great memories with my grandpa growing up. I think some of my earliest memories were him coming to spend the night at my house. I remember calling, asking him to come spend the night when we first moved here. And you know, we would joke about how I would always get the top bunk, he would get the bottom bunk, and that wasn't something he really would fight me on. It wouldn't be till later when when he'd be waking me up to go to school, to drive us to school, that I would be more frustrated with him spending the night or coming early. And so,
right.
But, I mean, those memories continued on. I mean, a lot of the time spent in his garage working on cars, mostly holding the light or fetching bolts that would fall to the ground. It wouldn't be till later when he would be the one holding the light and fetching bolts that fell to the ground. We would joke about how, in our own sense of humor, I guess, that how lucky we were they didn't have a pinky anymore, so he could reach for those bolts a lot easier. He had a great sense of humor, and I'm really going to miss that about him. I'm going to miss a lot of things about my grandpa. Very, very caring, very forgiving. He let me, he would let me take his RV, so many memories with the RV, and taking the RV to my senior prom for some reason with a bunch of guys, and then the next year taking his Cadillac to my wife's senior prom. And so things that I would probably not let my son do, but he seemed to be okay with his grandson doing it. I don't know if I could ever do any wrong in his eyes, but I'm really going to cherish all those memories with him. And I'm just glad we could all get together for this. So.
That's awesome, Bob.
Oh, thank you. So I'm his granddaughter, Dina, and I just wanted to kind of talk about another like sleepover memory I had from when we were little. But when I was young, I was afraid to like sleep in my own bed for like an embarrassing amount of time. And so I'd go over to sleep at their house, and they would always, my grandma and Harvey, my grandpa, would always let me sleep, I know, between them. So I would snuggle in between them when I was a kid, and I remember sleeping at their house, and Harvey and I would sneak chocolate together and watch movies, and just like falling asleep, tucked up on his shoulder, and just feeling really safe. And I think that he had that effect on people. He made people feel really safe.
And the battery may be dead. It was blinking. Yeah.
I think we'll all miss him a lot, so myself included. Yeah.
I do have this mic here that you can speak into. I promise I don't have anything. Is there anyone else who would like to share? Sure. I'll just kind of stand in your direction some. Because, yeah, this baby's dead.
You can probably hear me anyway, but my Uncle Harvey was pretty special to me. In fact, he was really the only man that I could really model after. And he always told me, he says, Raymond, always be good to your family. Always remember your family. And then to show you what a good guy he was, he'd come up to visit only maybe once or twice every year. And he'd say, Raymond, what do you want to do? And I'd say, well, I'd like to go fishing. Okay. So he'd take me out, we'd catch whatever we caught out there out in the Columbia. And then I came to California one year, and once again, he says, Raymond, what would you like to do? And I said, well, I'd like to go fishing. So we went up to the Delta in California there, and he rowed me around in his boat. He rowed around all day. We didn't catch a stinking. And so a few years ago, I was up, and something came up about, I think it was Uncle Ed's boat, and we were talking, and I said, well, you like fishing, don't you? And he said, Raymond, I hate fishing. And to me, that showed me what kind of a man he was, to be that special.
Right.
So I've always had a place in my heart. He's probably the most wonderful man I knew, so. Been a pleasure to even get to be around him. So thank you.
That's awesome. Anyone else? Sure.
Well, I just wanted to say that I can remember, I was pretty little at the time, but my Uncle Harvey, his mother was passing away, and my mom and Aunt Myrd and all of them went down there to California to be with her on her last, and he took care of them very well. He would take them out, do things with them to get their mind off their mama, and he did everything for them. And then my son come down here to Boise area, and he didn't have a place to live. He got a job down, but didn't have a place to live. Uncle Harvey says, well, come on, you can stay in my motorhome. He stayed there for 2 or 3 weeks, and you know, him and my wife did, and got him a place to live down here. And Harvey was always the type of person, he always had a smile on his face, and he always took care of people, and he always was really, really super nice, what I mind about him most. But I remember my mom came back and how he always took care of him. And I remember the name he always called all of his sisters. He said, hey, sis. He never called him by the name, hey, sis, all the time. He was such a good guy. Mm.
Wonderful memories, right? Absolutely. Sure. Back here? Yeah. I'll just kind of sit next to you.
Uh-huh. Harvey was such a wonderful person. He was an animal lover, and all animals were attracted to him. He enjoyed Sophie, their little black dachshund, and now Gracie. And that, to me, is a sign of a wonderful person, when animals are drawn to them.
Absolutely.
And just wonderful memories of his kindness and caring attitude towards everything in life. Mm. Thank you.
It's beautiful. Sure.
My folks and Betty and Harvey were best of friends. Betty and my mom were double cousins, so they were always close. And we had so many wonderful memories of traveling to California to go stay with them. And they had a pool, and we all just loved it so much. And we would go then. They would come on down with us, on down to Disneyland, and take my son and Kumi and Glenn. And I remember one time we were staying in a motel, and Glenn was like 2 years old, I think, and he took apart the sink and the toilet at the hotel. And Harvey said, well, that's okay, he can put it back together. And sure enough, he did. I don't know how that young he learned that. But anyway, Harvey just loved the kids and was always so fun to be around. Oh. And we really miss him. We will really miss him.
Yeah. Great tributes. Absolutely. Anyone else? Okay. Sure.
I'll just stand up.
Okay.
Yeah, I've known Harvey for 45 years. A lot of you know him a lot more, but I married. His daughter. I was trying to find him. So you cry there. One of the things, in the tribute, it mentions that Harvey always had a project. He's always working on a car. Well, he brought up I think it was a 67 white Cadillac from, 64. What?
64.
Well, 64, okay. And we were living up in Maple Valley, Washington, and so he had the car up here, and we found out that there was a car show in Covington, and so we're just going to go down there and check out all the cars. Well, here we are, we're driving in to find a place to park, and this guy is waving us on in. He waved us into the car show. he opens up his hood, he opens up his trunk, and, you know, just talking to everybody about his car, you know.
And
of course, he was detail-oriented.
Yeah.
So that car was immaculate, just very, very fixed up, you know. But that 64 Cadillac was so long. We went into one residential area that has control bumps, and it just drug all the way across each of the bumps, you know, as you'd hit them, you know. So it was really. Was that?
The time they fixed our car, we went to
Oh, yeah. We were going to take the family, went down to see Bob, and we were taking the family to Disneyland, and we had a Capri car, and we're on the way to Disneyland, the car broke down. Well, Bob and Harvey went over and said, here, take our car, go to Disneyland, and they rebuilt the car on the side of the freeway. They had to take the headers off and do a bunch of things to get the engine to work right, and they put it all back together, and it was on the side of the freeway on the way to Disneyland, and then they just took the car back the other way. So, but to get to know him, to travel out to Wendell, to where, you know, he grew up as a kid, great memories he had of living there, and locking his sister in the well house. You know, that was quite a story. The other was just to see the haystacks, you know, because I came from California and we had balers, you know, but they just had these big poles that would stack all the hay, you know, and how they would stack all the hay there, you know, and then he was telling us about all these popular, very popular trees out there, the poplars. Mm-hmm. But it was, just great to see his place where he grew up and the history there, and about how they would put, grow a crop along the side of the road. It was they were at kind of a plateau area type thing, and they had crops there for when people would come by, they would have food for people that had a journey to go down the road further. So, but fixing cars, fixing his yard, great picture of him out here, you know, his yard was always immaculate. Mine, I worked at it, but not to the degree he did, you know. But he one time he was trimming the top of a tree with a chainsaw, top of the stepladder, he went up into the tree, and then he was up in the tree with this chainsaw, cutting the top out of the tree, and he fell out of the tree, you know, and so he was in a body cast and laid up, and he wound up shorter because he compressed some disc there, you know. But
that doctor that was about 5'2" was saying, you know, he's going to be shorter.
So it was just, to all the projects he had, and of course his workshop was always very immaculate because he came from the aircraft area where you had to make sure you had your tools in shape and all very well organized. Yeah, until Alan got a hold of the shop once, Dad got a bit upset with you that time, didn't you?
Well, a couple times.
Yeah, but what was the one time you said to him?
What is it you said to him?
One time, Dad was furious, just all red about the tools being all
and
over.
And Alan stood up and said, "Digga, digga, digga, digga,
yeah,
digga."
Yeah.
Whatever that means.
Right.
Right.
That diffused it.
Meant that's what it's about. But a lot of memories.
Yeah. It's awesome. It's terrific. It's what makes life the beautiful thing it is, isn't it? It's those little memories. Those everyday things. You know, Alan, you had said that, and it's a sign of a great teacher. You said he taught without you even knowing that you were being taught. Yeah, that's pretty cool. Trying to think how I want to approach this now. I find it fascinating that it's our human nature, and this is the pastor speaking now, right? The pastor and me, that we ponder what heaven is like. In the Bible, there's a lot of metaphor, there's a lot of symbolism. Try to get across the inexpressible. And well, here's my best take on this matter of heaven and Harvey, okay?
I mean, after hearing about him and his life and his passion and what a kind gentleman he was and his impact upon you guys, Harvey's in heaven, all right. That's kind of a no-brainer. It's evident because of how what you're saying here, how he treated others, lived his life. It's like he carried, and even if it was unbeknownst to him, he was carrying around with him a little bit of heaven. Okay, that's what it seems like. A character who really was a man of character, a child of God now filled with the wonder and peace beyond our greatest imaginings in God's kingdom now. What we see in heaven according to the Bible is that we become thoroughly the person God designed us to be. Thoroughly joyful to the very marrow of our bones and every tear wiped away. It's hard to even fathom what it is that Harvey is standing in the midst of pure love. But for us, right, while we have these wonderful memories, it is bittersweet. I mean, with the laughter, there's the tears. It's a bittersweet mixture of joy that they're in heaven, but one coupled with this sense of loss, for we miss them so. It's something we call love. Yeah. Love at its most basic is one of sacrifice. We discover that at moments like this. There's a realization that while Harvey was alive, right, that we freely gave of our time to be with him, and he freely gave of his time to be with us. And it's like when someone like Harvey leaves, they take a little bit of us with them, the time, the energy, the passion, the joy, the frustrations, whatever. But they take a little bit of us with them because we gave them our most precious gift as they gave us their most precious gift, which is time that we have here. And so there is this sense of grief that a part of us goes with them, but there's also this sense of joy that we have a part of them. We have a part of Harvey within us. And we're thinking to ourselves, and I think you are, you know what? All that time I spent with him is well spent. And if I had the opportunity to do it again, I would. And if I could just hear his voice one more time, I'd give anything for it. And how often do we take for granted hearing each other's voice, right? Because of Harvey, think about this. You are more, what would you say? A word. You are more what? Anyone?
Happier.
Kind.
Grateful.
Appreciative. Right? Wouldn't it be cool if such things could be said of us when we leave this world? I mean, really? He's in heaven. And with faith, I say that. We all say that. With hope, we believe that. I mean, dagnabbit, I have a doctorate in theology, right? PhD in theology. And I mumble and stumble through moments like this. It's beyond my imaginings. But I know he's with God. Because he shared in a beautiful way with God's children in this world. He shared his best way of loving others. God is love and love is God. Can't describe it. You'll fall short. It's like a eulogy, you know, that I'm mumbling through here. You know, you meaning well, and logi meaning words. Speaking well of someone and trying to encompass their life, you can't. You can't encompass a life. You already give up that you're going to fail in the endeavor. But we've got to make that endeavor to share, right? Because that person meant so much to us. How can one encompass a life with a eulogy or a memorial, a moment like this? You can't. And that's okay. That's all right. You can't sum up a life or the impact that someone like Harvey has had on this world. I mean, here's a man who served the country his country so well in the Navy with profound dedication and commitment. And that sacrifice that he made, of that dedication and commitment to serving this nation, that continues to this day. And who knows how many people were impacted with the freedoms we have today that we take for granted, that Harvey and so many other men and women have given of themselves in the armed forces. That sacrifice continues to impact this world and this life and this nation as we know it. And it's beautiful. Now, I think I'm correct here. As a young boy, help me here. Harvey experienced early on in life a tragic occurrence, the illness and the death of his little sister. She was, what, like around two or so? I mean, she was young. Yeah. And bless his heart, here's Harvey, a little boy, losing a sibling. And it was under circumstances that could have been prevented, but religion kind of finagled its way into the family, thinking, well, God's going to take care of it. We don't need to take care of, you know, we don't need to rely upon the medicine or the medical care. And that was particularly for a particular member of that family who believed that way. And and I'm thinking, that's a profound experience, no matter how old you are. I mean, I know this personally. I mean, my father passed away when I was two. That has impacted my life for these past 60 years. It has. And I'm thinking, Harvey losing his sister from something that could have been treated back then, which was appendicitis, that had to, you know, that has to impact an individual. And you wonder, okay, here I am a pastor, and people say, well, God will intervene. And here's Harvey's young boy thinking, well, God did not intervene for my sister. I mean, you had to have at least had that thought cross your brainwaves at one point. But to Harvey's credit, bless his heart, he didn't become anti-religious. He didn't get real involved in institutional religion. I get it. I fight it all the time. But he was obviously sad, and I'm sure was broken in ways he didn't even understand as a young boy. But I bet, I just bet, and I'm just surmising here, maybe I'm way off base, but I'm just thinking an experience like that would played a role in the person who Harvey became in life. Think so? Somehow he found a way to walk through the pain, because we know that pain doesn't go away. It just transforms. It stays with us at some level. And I do believe it empowered and challenged Harvey to be a healing presence in this world that would try to fix things as best he could if he had the opportunity. Maybe, just maybe, that early life experience of something that could have been avoided drove Harvey to embrace a spirit who wanted to help fix and repair and heal things that he thought he could take a stab at and help. Just wondering. Recently in worship, I said these words, and I think Harvey would agree with me on this. I said, God will not do for us that which we are capable of doing. God put us in this world to make a difference, right? To use what we have. And I think Harvey deep down said, I have these gifts. I have this desire, this passion for hobbies, but also to learn how an engine works or how a plane flies or how a car goes down the road or how to be there for a family member and love them and care for them and be kind and be a healing presence. He strove to take care of the relationships in his life. It's obvious. He cherished the roles of being a husband and a father and a grandfather and a friend. Deep down, it seems like Harvey, in his own way, was trying to alleviate whatever brokenness or suffering came his way. Whatever broken down car or person who is hurting or needs some guidance. Loved, as we've heard over and over, to refurbish cars and work on airplanes. Took great pride in landscaping to the point where it was beauty that he was bringing into this world. He was doing that task that God gave us in the Garden of Eden, taking care of the gardens of Eden of this world and creating our own little Eden existence for others to appreciate. His love for entertaining family and friends reminded, I think, all of you guys of how important it is to get together, and not just moments like this. Traveling and exploring new places, natural extension of his love for life. He was a caretaker, and he was entrusted to take care of those around him, to be a good steward of this world. It even sounds like maybe he was a little plant whisperer, right? He could see a plant, and if there was an issue with it, he'd kind of figure out what it needed to be able to grow and blossom and be whatever God intended it to be. I love that he had a good sense of humor. I love that. Sounds like he was one of those rare people with his sense of humor as well, who didn't judge people. In this world of Instagram and social media, oh my gosh, we quickly make those judgments and opinions of people, right? To hear that there was someone who didn't rush to judgment, who didn't judge others, oh my. We could use a few more Harveys in this world. Sounds like he respected the life journey of others. He was described as stubborn, but not really stubborn in a negative way, I guess. Kind of like strong-willed and creative. And I'm thinking about this. Think about this. Blend those two attributes together. You get an impactful life. You get a man with deeply held beliefs that would stand his ground for them. But those beliefs guided a creative spirit that was constantly attentive to looking for ways to make the world perhaps more beautiful or kind, or to repair that which was broken in this world. Huh. Harvey. That's a great name, too. I love that. Reminds me of Jimmy Stewart's movie, Harvey, with the rabbit. 6-foot rabbit. A person determined to help fix, improve things, and he saw what the world could be like. And it takes some elbow grease, and hard work, and a strong will to see it through, and he had it. And yet there was something about Harvey also that I really, when I heard about it, that even just made me fall in love with the man even more. That he was willing to acknowledge when he made a misstep. And he was humble enough to say those two words that sadly many of us have a hard time spitting out. Those words, I'm sorry. And to be able to say it in a timely fashion. Huh. We can't overstate the importance of those words. And as we heard in the sharing, you know, as a family member said, you know, that he didn't have the best father role model growing up, but he had Harvey. And Harvey taught him what it meant and what it looked like to be a good father. Is there any greater legacy to leave than to leave with a family member modeling what it means to have to be a loving, caring father for your kids? And to pass that on to your kids and then to your children's children. I mean, that is a legacy that goes on. Harvey's still with us. That's a beautiful thing. So he's still impacting this world. He is. Sensitive and empathetic. The loss of family members in his lifetime hit him at the very core. But he was determined to love, to heal, to beautify this world. One little story and I'll end. I'll just zip it. And Bob, and I will, you know, I'll zip it. Promise. It was shared with me, and Bob alluded to it, his grandson. During Harvey's lifetime, he did wood cutting, right? And as you know, most of you, on one occasion, he cut a little more than just wood, right? He kind of cut off his pinky and the lower part of his hand. That old injury, though, it almost freed him to begin to get back to fixing this world the way he wants to fix it. For you see, in his latter days, when he was in the hospital dealing with health issues, and I'm sure, you know, trying to get his body regulated on medication, you know, your mind, and it's going everywhere in the body, it's just like, what's going on? Restraints were put on his arms, as often happens, you know, to keep him in bed and keep him from pulling at the leads or the wires or whatever, you know, drips were connected to his body. But that one hand that was kind of minus a pinky in the lower part of the hand, it kept slipping out of the restraints. And I cannot help but think what went through his mind at that moment when he saw that hand free. Likely, there was that inner drive and desire to be productive and to fix and to care, because laying around in bed, that didn't sound like something Harvey was designed to do. It's pretty clear to me, there was no restraining of Harvey Clampett. Maybe later in life, they kind of figured out how to restrain him physically, even with his partial hand. But there was no restraining his spirit. Mm-mm. That can-do spirit of resiliency, a spirit that rose above and through tragedy and tough circumstances. For Harvey knew that there was a world out there you can make a difference in and you can fix. You have the opportunity, go for it. He did the best he could. Living a life of love. Devoted to nation, to family, to friends. God bless you, Harvey. I'm sorry we didn't get to meet, but I'm telling you, I'm feeling like I've met you in this beautiful gathering here. Rest well, dear friend. Rest well. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, as we bring this memorial time to a close. It's really, we close this curtain, but another curtain opens. Life continues. We just want to express to you, dear God, a deep love and appreciation that you blessed lives, so many lives here and in this world of yours, and continue to do so through Harvey. You had plans for him, and it's like he saw the plans laid out, and he just lived his life and did the best he could with those amazing blueprints that you made up his life. Watch over him, dear God. There'll be a time we'll be together again. In faith, we proclaim that. But in the meantime, as you watch over and care for Harvey, and he's hard at work up there, because we do here in heaven that we get to work in a very productive way we could never imagine here on earth. We ask, while he's busy doing his thing with you, that we continue to stay busy doing our thing with you as well, dear God. Taking the lessons that Harvey has taught us, remembering his character, his personality, his spirit, and having that encourage us and instill us to be a better human being. To be who you want us to be. So thank you for Harvey. And thank you for your son, who makes all of this be able to happen. And it's in your son's spirit we pray. Amen. Dear friends, may the peace of Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. God bless you. There is food in the fireside room. I guess I would ask the family. Yes. And there's a sign-up book. Please be sure to sign. Yes. There you go. Absolutely. It really will be. And it will be for years to come. If you can sign and maybe write a little memory. You guys enjoy each other. Enjoy the food. And be a blessing to one another as Harvey would want you to be. God bless you.